You know what the realm is. It's the thousand blades of Aegon's enemies. A story we agree to tell each other over and over till we forget that it's a lie.
What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome back for another A Song of Ice and Fire video. Today I want to read another chapter from the books, but this time I want to add a little more of my own thoughts at the beginning of the video and at the end of the video. The first two chapter readings I had done was because I wanted to show you the differences between the Red Wedding in the show and the Red Wedding in the books. I did the same thing for one of Dany's chapters when she enters the House of the Undying, but today I want to talk about one of my personal favorite chapters from the books. The chapter I'm covering today is one of Bran Stark's, and it's his last chapter in the final book, A Dance with Dragons. In my opinion, this is one of the most interesting ones because it's packed full with so much different information, and this chapter also helped create so many different theories I'm sure most of you have heard by now. If you follow along with me, you may be able to see some of the clues or foreshadowing for things to come. This is the chapter where Bran Stark starts to understand what it means to be a Greenseer. The Children of the Forest and the Three-Eyed Crow are preparing Bran for what's to come. Because as we all know, Bran is a very powerful character, but he doesn't know how to harness this power yet. In this chapter, Bran learns how to fly, in more than one way. This is when we see Bran look through the eyes of the Weirwood Tree for the first time, and he sees some very interesting things. This allows Bran to look out into Winterfell's Godswood, and he's able to look back in time to things that happened hundreds and even thousands of years ago. We learn that a Weirwood Tree is the first set of eyes a Greenseer is able to use, but in time, Bran will be able to see far beyond the trees themselves. Right before Bran goes into the Weirwood Net, he is given a bowl of paste that is said to help him use his powers, and many people believe this paste is actually Jojen Reed. Over the course of this chapter, you will notice Jojen Reed is becoming more distant by the day. His job was to get Bran to the cave, and now that he's done that, he knows his days are numbered, which would make anyone depressed. But then Jojen just all of a sudden disappears from the chapter. Then Bran is given this paste that looks very similar to blood, and there is a very good chance Jojen Reed was sacrificed by the Children of the Forest. There is also some other evidence that may suggest the children were feeding all of them human flesh since they've entered the cave. They are given mystery meat, and I believe it could be from a person and not an animal, but that's also open for debate. A few months ago, I made a video about the Children of the Forest, and I'm not sure how many of you have seen that video, but I think there could be a faction of the Children of the Forest that are still evil, or working with the White Walkers. I would love to go into all the details right now, but this video is already too long, but I highly recommend that you watch my other video, that way this makes more sense. I will put the link down below. But basically, I think there is a good chance they could be using Bran Stark so he can assist them into getting the Army of the Dead south of the Wall. I think the Three-Eyed Raven could be lying to Bran, and I think the Children of the Forest could be lying to Bran as well. There are a few interesting quotes in this chapter that help support this theory, in my opinion. I think they were using Jojen Reed as a puppet to help get Bran to the cave, and once he did that for them, he was killed, then turned into a paste and fed to Bran to awaken his powers even more. If the Jojen paste theory is true, then the children's methods are obviously very dark. Then, at the very beginning of the story, Old Nan tells Bran not to trust crows because they're all liars.
Don't listen to it. Crows are all liars.
Well, in this chapter, Bran wants to know what happened to the rest of the Children of the Forest, so Leif tells him they're mostly dead, along with most of the magical animals like direwolves, unicorns, and great lions, just to name a few. She says there is no room for any of them in this new world the men are creating. Thanks to mankind, they are killing everything. After Bran is told this story, he reflects on what she said. Bran is surprised that the Children of the Forest are not angry. He thinks if this were to happen to men, they would be wroth and seek vengeance. But the children seem so sweet and innocent. I think this is setting up a twist to come later. I think the children are still angry, and I think they are still seeking vengeance against man. After all, how did they end up on the wrong side of the wall with the White Walkers? The legend says the children helped build the wall to protect the south against the White Walkers, but somehow, the only children that seem to be alive are living in the heart of the north, in close proximity to the others. You would think if they did help build the wall, they would be given a safe place to stay on the south side of it, but they weren't. There is something else that happens in this chapter that I think is fascinating, and I have my own theory on what it could mean. We learn a lot of cool details about the Three-Eyed Raven's cave in this chapter. It's much bigger than any of us could have imagined. It has tunnels and passageways that go so deep, even the children that are living in the cave haven't been able to explore them all. Leaf even says you can reach the center of the earth if you follow the tunnels far enough. There are also sections of the cave that are forbidden. Bran, Mira, Jojen, and Hodor are told not to go wandering too far around the cave. But one day, Bran goes inside of Hodor's body, and he goes exploring on his own. When Bran does this, he finds more children of the forest that no one told him about, almost as if they were hiding them. Now what's interesting is, these children of the forest are entangled into the roots, just like Bloodraven. When Bran sees them all tangled up in the roots, just laying there, he at first thinks they are dead, but they aren't. One of them opens his eyes, and he even moves his mouth as if he were trying to speak. Up until now, all the children we have met are female. Leaf, Snowy Locks, Coles, they're all female. But the one Bran finds entangled in the tree is a male, because Bran refers to him as a he. People have always wondered, why are all the White Walkers male and all the Children of the Forest female? But in this instance, there is a living male member of the Children of the Forest, but they have him hidden deep in the cave and entangled in the weirwood roots like Bloodraven. Since we know the children actually created the White Walkers, I think these hidden members of the children are actually a completely different faction, and they may be the ones who are controlling the Army of the Dead. Bran thought they were dead when he found them, but they weren't. His eyes opened, and his mouth moved, but he made no sound. I think his conscious is actually inside a White Walker or the Army of the Dead. As of right now, there is no Night King in the books. He has not been introduced, so no one actually knows who is controlling all of the Whites, but I think it could be these children that are locked away in the deeper, darker sections of the cave. This is just a theory though, but I feel like something else is going on inside of that cave. But anyways, let's move on. There is another theory that is kinda crazy, but if you do a Google search, I guarantee you will find something. Some people believe Bran Stark will have sex with Mira Reed. But since Bran is crippled, he might use Hodor's body to have sex with Mira. I know it sounds crazy and creepy, but I wanted to mention that because some of the evidence that is used for that theory comes from this chapter, because later in the chapter, Mira Reed begins to cry, and Bran wants to comfort her, but she's too far away for him to do this, without having to drag himself across the cave floor. So Bran thinks about using Hodor's body so he can walk over to Mira and let her cry on his shoulder. Well, according to the theory, Bran will eventually take it one step further by having sex with Mira Reed when he's inside Hodor's body. There is also some more evidence in the chapter that may explain where the direwolves actually come from. The Three-Eyed Crow explains the importance of eye color to Bran. He says the old gods mark those who have received their gift by giving them golden eyes, green eyes, and on very rare occasions, some will be given red eyes. If you think about all of the direwolves, he mentions their eye colors. This even proves just how special Ghost is, because very few characters in this story have red eyes. But Ghost is one of them, along with Bloodraven, Melisandre, the Ghost of Highheart, and even Drogon has red eyes. Plus, we all know the weirwood trees have red eyes as well. If you can, follow along with me as I read this chapter, because it is filled to the brim with interesting details about many different important things in the story. At the end of this chapter, I will do a quick breakdown of what Bran actually sees when he is looking through the eyes of the Heart Tree at Winterfell. So with that being said, let's begin. The moon was a crescent, thin and sharp as the blade of a knife. A pale sun rose and set and rose again. Red leaves whispered in the wind. Dark clouds filled the skies and turned to storms. Lightning flashed and thunder rumbled, and dead men with black hands and bright blue eyes shuffled round a cleft in the hillside but could not enter. Under the hill, the broken boy sat upon a weirwood throne, listening to the whispers in the dark as ravens walked up and down his arms. "You will never walk again," the Three-Eyed Crow had promised, "but you will fly." Sometimes the sound of song would drift up from someplace far below. The children of the forest, old Nan would have called the singers, but those who sing the song of the earth was their own name for themselves. in the true tongue that no human man could speak. The ravens could speak it, though. Their small black eyes were full of secrets, and they would call at him and peck his skin when they heard the songs. The moon was fat and full. Stars wheeled across a black sky. Rain fell and froze, and tree limbs snapped from the weight of the ice. Bran and Mira made up names for those who sang the song of the earth. Ash and Leaf and Scales, Black Knife and Snowy Locks and Coals. Their true names were too long for human tongues, said Leaf. Only she could speak the common tongue, so what the others thought of their new names, Bran never learned. After the bone-grinding cold of the lands beyond the wall, the caves were blessedly warm, and when the chill crept out of the rocks, the singers would light fires to drive it off again. Down here, there was no wind, no snow, no ice, no dead things reaching out to grab you. Only dreams and rushlight and the kisses of the ravens, and the whisperer in the darkness. The last greenseer, the singers called him, but in Bran's dreams, he was still a three-eyed crow. When Mira Reed had asked him his true name, he made a ghastly sound that might have been a chuckle. I wore many names when I was quick. But even I once had a mother, and the name she gave me at her breast was Brendan. I have an uncle named Brendan, Bran said. He's my mother's uncle, really. Brendan Blackfish, he's called. Your uncle may have been named for me. Some are, still. Not so many as before. Men forget. Only the trees remember. His voice was so soft that Bran had to strain to hear. Most of him has gone into the tree, explained the singer Mira called Leaf. He has lived beyond his mortal span, and yet he lingers. For us. For you, for the realms of men. Only a little strength remains in his flesh. He has 1,000 eyes in one, but there is much to watch. One day you will know. What will I know? Bran asked the reeds afterwards, when they came with torches burning brightly in their hand, to carry him back to a small chamber off of the big cavern where the singers had made beds for them to sleep. What do the trees remember? The secrets of the old gods, said Jojen Reed. Food and fire and rest had helped restore him after the ordeals of their journey, but he seemed sadder now, sullen, with a weary, haunted look about the eyes. Truce the first men knew, forgotten now in Winterfell, but not in the wet wild. We live closer to the green in our bogs and crannogs, and we remember. Earth and water, soil and stone, oaks and elms and willows, they were here before us all and will remain when we are gone. So will you, said Mira, and that made Bran sad. What if I don't want to remain when you are gone? He almost asked, but he swallowed the words unspoken. He was almost a man grown, and he did not want Mira to think he was some weepy babe. Maybe you could be Grain Seers too, he said instead. No, Bran. Now Mira sounded sad. It is given to a few to drink of that green fountain while still in mortal flesh, to hear the whisperings of the leaves, and see as the trees see, as the gods see, said Jojen. Most are not so blessed. The gods gave me only green dreams. My task was to get you here. My part in this is done. The moon was a black hole in the sky. Wolves howled in the wood, sniffing through the snowdrifts after dead things. A murder of ravens erupted from the hillside, screaming their sharp cries, black wings beating above a white world. A red sun rose and set and rose again, painting the snows in shades of rose and pink. Under the hill, Jojen brooded, Mira fretted, and Hodor wandered through dark tunnels with a sword in his right hand and a torch in his left. Or was it Bran wandering? No one must ever know. The great cavern that opened on the abyss was as black as pitch, black as tar, blacker than the feathers of a crow. Light entered as a trespasser, unwanted and unwelcome, and soon was gone again. Cookfires, candles, and rushes burned for a little while, then guttered out again, their brief lives at an end. The singers made Bran a throne of his own, like the one Lord Brendan sat, white weirwood flecked with red, dead branches woven through living roots. They placed it in the great cavern by the abyss, where the black air echoed to the sound of running water far below. Of soft gray moss they made his seat. Once he had been lowered into place, they covered him with warm furs. There he sat, listening to the hoarse whispers of his teacher. Never fear the darkness, Bran. The Lord's words were accompanied by a faint rustling of wooden leaf, a slight twisting of his head. The strongest trees are rooted in the dark places of the earth. Darkness will be your cloak, your shield, your mother's milk. Darkness will make you strong. The moon was a crescent, thin and sharp as the blade of a knife. Snowflakes drifted down soundlessly to cloak the soldier pines and sentinels in white. The drifts grew so deep that they covered the entrance to the caves, leaving a white wall that Summer had to dig through whenever he went outside to join his pack and hunt. Bran did not often range with them in those days, but some nights he watched them from above. Flying was even better than climbing. Slipping into Summer's skin had become as easy for him as slipping on a pair of breeches once had been, before his back was broken. Changing his own skin for a raven's night black feathers had been harder, but not as hard as he had feared. Not with these ravens. A wild stallion will buck and kick when a man tries to mount him, and try to bite the hand that slips the bit between his teeth, Lord Brendan said, but a horse that has known one rider will accept another. Young or old, these birds have all been ridden. Choose one now and fly. He chose one bird, and then another, without success, but the third raven looked at him with shrewd black eyes, tilted its head, and gave a quark, and quick as that he was not a boy looking at a raven, but a raven looking at a boy. The song of the river suddenly grew louder, the torches burned a little brighter than before, and the air was full of strange smells. When he tried to speak, it came out in a scream, and his first flight ended when he crashed into a wall and ended back inside his own broken body. The raven was unhurt. It flew to him and landed on his arm, and Bran stroked its feathers and slipped inside of it again. Before long, he was flying around the cavern, weaving through the long stone teeth that hung down from the ceiling, even flapping out over the abyss and swooping down into its cold black depths. Then he realized he was not alone. Someone else was in the raven, he told Lord Brendan, once he had returned to his own skin. Some girl, I felt her. A woman, of those who sing the song of the earth, his teacher said. Long dead, yet a part of her remains, just as a part of you would remain in Summer if your boy's flesh were to die upon the morrow. A shadow on the soul. She will not harm you. Do all the birds have singers in them? All, Lord Brendan said. It was the singers who taught the first men to send messages by raven. But in those days, the birds would speak the words. The trees remember, but men forget. And so now they write the messages on parchment and tie them round the feet of birds who have never shared their skin. Old Nan had told him the same story once, Bran remembered. But when he asked Rob if it was true, his brother laughed and asked him if he believed in grumpkins too. He wished Rob were with them now. I tell him I could fly, but he wouldn't believe me, so I'd have to show him. I bet that he could learn to fly too. Him and Arya and Sansa. Even baby Rickon and Jon Snow. We could all be ravens and live in Maester Luwyn's rookery. That was just another silly dream, though. Some days, Bran wondered if all of this wasn't just some dream. Maybe he had fallen asleep out in the snows and dreamed himself a safe, warm place. You have to wake, he would tell himself. You have to wake right now, or you'll go dreaming into death. Once or twice, he pinched his arm with his fingers, really hard, but the only thing that did was make his arm hurt. In the beginning, he had to try to count the days by making note of when he woke and slept, but down here, sleeping and waking had a way of melting into one another. Dreams became lessons. Lessons became dreams. Things happened all at once or not at all. He had done that or only dreamed it. Only one man in 1,000 is born a skin changer, Lord Brendan said one day, after Bran had learned to fly, and only one skin changer in 1,000 can be a green seer. I thought the green seers were the wizards of the children, Bran said. The singers, I mean. In a sense, those you call the children of the forest have eyes as golden as the sun. But once in a great while, one is born amongst them with eyes as red as blood, or green as the moss on a tree in the heart of the forest. By these signs do the gods mark those they have chosen to receive the gift. The chosen ones are not robust, and their quick years upon the earth are few, for every song must have its balance. But once inside the wood they linger long indeed. 1,000 eyes, 100 skins, wisdom deep as the roots of ancient trees. Green seers. Bran did not understand, so he asked the reeds. Do you like to read books, Bran? Jojen asked him. Some books. I like the fighting stories. My sister Sansa liked the kissing stories, but those are stupid. A reader lives 1,000 lives before he dies, said Jojen. The man who never reads lives only one. The singers of the forest had no books, no ink, no parchment, no written language. Instead, they had the trees, and the weirwoods above all. When they died, they went into the wood, into leaf and limb and root, and the trees remembered. All their songs and spells, their histories and prayers, everything they knew about this world. Maesters will tell you that the weirwoods are sacred to the old gods. The singers believe they are the old gods. When singers die, they become part of that godhood. Bran's eyes widened. They're gonna kill me? No, Mira said. Jojen, you're scaring him. He is not the one who needs to be afraid. The moon was fat and full. Summer prowled through the silent woods, a long gray shadow that grew more gaunt with every hunt, for living game could not be found. The ward upon the cave mouth still held. The dead men could not enter. The snows had buried most of them again, but they were still there, hidden, frozen, waiting. Other dead things came to join them, things that had once been men and women, even children. Dead ravens sat on bare brown branches, wings crusted with ice. A snow bear crashed through the brush, huge and skeletal, half its head sloughed away to reveal the skull beneath. Summer and his pack fell upon it and tore it into pieces. Afterwards, they gorged, though the meat was rotten and half frozen, and moved even as they ate it. Under the hill, they still had food to eat. 100 kinds of mushrooms grew down here. Blind white fish swam in the Black River, but they tasted just as good as fish with eyes once you cooked them up. They had cheese and milk from the goats that shared the caves with the singers, even some oats and barley corn and dried fruit laid by during the long summer. And almost every day they ate blood stew, thickened with barley and onions and chunks of meat. Jojen thought it might be squirrel meat, and Mira said that it was a rat. Bran did not care. It was meat, and it was good. The stewing made it tender. The caves were timeless, vast, silent. They were home to more than 60 living singers and the bones of thousands dead, and extended far below the Hollow Hill. Men should not go wandering in this place, Leif warned them. The river you hear is swift and black, and flows down and down to a sunless sea, and there are passages that go even deeper, bottomless pits and sudden shafts, forgotten ways that lead to the very center of the earth. Even my people have not explored them all, and we have lived here for 1,000,000 of your man years. Though the men of the Seven Kingdoms might call the children of the forest, Leif and her people were far from children. Little wise men of the forest would have been closer. They were small compared to men, as a wolf is smaller than a direwolf, but that does not mean it is a pup. They had nut-brown skin, dappled like a deer's with paler spots, and large ears that could hear things that no man could hear. Their eyes were big too, great golden cat's eyes that could see down passages where a boy's eyes saw only blackness. Their hands had only 3 fingers and a thumb, with sharp black claws instead of nails. And they did sing. They sang in true tongue, so Bran could not understand the words, but their voices were as pure as winter air. "Where are the rest of you?" Bran asked Leif once. "Gone down into the earth," she answered. "Into the stones. Into the trees. Before the first men came, all this land that you call Westeros was home to us. Yet even in those days, we were few. The gods gave us long lives, but not great numbers. Lest we overrun the world as deer will overrun a wood where there are no wolves to hunt them. That was in the dawn of days, when our sun was rising. Now it sinks, and this is our long dwindling. The giants are almost gone as well, they who were our bane and our brothers. The great lions of the western hills have been slain. The unicorns are all but gone. The mammoths down to a few hundred. The dire wolves will outlast us all, but their time will come as well. In the world that men have made, there is no room for them or us." She seemed sad when she said it, and that made Bran sad as well. It was only later that he thought, men would not be sad, men would be wroth, men would hate and swear a bloody vengeance. The singers sang sad songs where men would fight and kill. One day Mira and Jojen decided to go see the river, despite Leif's cautions. "I want to come too," Bran said. Mira gave him a mournful look. The river was 600 feet below, down steep slopes and twisty passages, she explained, and the last part required climbing down a rope. "Hodor could never make the climb with you on his back. I'm sorry, Bran." Bran remembered a time when no one could climb as good as him, not even Rob or Jon. Part of him wanted to shout at them for leaving him, and another part wanted to cry. He was almost a man grown, though, so he said nothing. But after they were gone, he slipped inside Hodor's skin and followed them. The big stable boy no longer fought him as he had the first time, back in the Lake Tower during the storm. Like a dog who has had all the fight whipped out of him, Hodor would curl up and hide whenever Bran reached out for him. His hiding place was somewhere deep within him, a pit where not even Bran could touch him. "No one wants to hurt you, Hodor," he said silently, to the child man whose flesh he'd taken. "I just want to be strong again for a while. I'll give it back, the way I always do." No one ever knew when he was wearing Hodor's skin. Bran only had to smile, do as he was told, and mutter Hodor from time to time, and he could follow Mira and Jojen, grinning happily, without anyone suspecting it was really him. He often tagged along whether he was wanted or not. In the end, the Reeds were glad he came. Jojen made it down the rope easily enough, but after Mira caught a blind white fish with her frog spear and it was time to climb back up, his arms began to tremble and he could not make it to the top. So they had to tie the rope around him and let Hodor haul him up. Hodor, he grunted every time he gave a pull. Hodor, Hodor, Hodor. The moon was a crescent, thin and sharp as the blade of a knife. Summer dug up a severed arm, black and covered with hoarfrost, its fingers opening and closing as it pulled itself across the frozen snow. There was still enough meat on it to fill his empty belly, and after that was done he cracked the arm bones for the marrow. Only then did the arm remember it was dead. Bran ate with Summer in his pack, as a wolf. As a raven he flew with the murder, circling the hill at sunset, watching for foes, feeling the icy touch of the air. As Hodor, he explored the caves. He found chambers full of bones, shafts that plunged deep into the earth, a place where the skeletons of gigantic bats hung upside down from the ceiling. He even crossed the slender stone bridge that arched over the abyss and discovered more passages and chambers on the far side. One was full of singers, enthroned like Brendan in nests of weirwood roots that wove under and through and around their bodies. Most of them looked dead to him, but as he crossed in front of them, their eyes would open and follow the light of his torch, and one of them opened and closed a wrinkled mouth, as if he were trying to speak. Hodor, Bran said to him, and he felt the real Hodor stir down in his pit. Seated on his throne of roots in the great cavern, half corpse and half tree, Lord Brendan seemed less a man than some ghastly statue made of twisted wood, old bone, and rotten wool. The only thing that looked alive in the pale ruin that was his face was his one red eye, burning like the last coal in a dead fire, surrounded by twisted roots and tatters of leathery white skin hanging off a yellowed skull. The sight of him still frightened Bran, the weirwood roots snaking in and out of his withered flesh, the mushrooms sprouting from his cheeks, the white wooden worm that grew from the socket where one eye had been. He liked it better when the torches were put out. In the dark, he could pretend that it was the three-eyed crow who whispered to him and not some grisly talking corpse. One day I will be like him. The thought filled Bran with dread. Bad enough that he was broken, with his useless legs. Was he doomed to lose the rest too? To spend all of his years with the weirwood growing in him and through him? Lord Brendan drew his life from the tree, Leif told them. He did not eat. He did not drink. He slept. He dreamed. He watched. I was going to be a knight, Bran remembered. I used to run and climb and fight. It seemed 1,000 years ago. What was he now? Only Bran the Broken Boy, Brandon of House Stark. Prince of a lost kingdom, lord of a burned castle, heir to ruins. He had thought the three-eyed crow would be a sorcerer, a wise old wizard who could fix his legs, but that was some stupid child's dream, he realized now. I'm too old for such fancies, he told himself. 1,000 eyes, 100 skins, wisdom deep as the roots of ancient trees. That was as good as being a knight. Almost as good, anyway. The moon was a black hole in the sky. Outside the cave, the world went on. Outside the cave, the sun rose and set. The moon turned, the cold winds howled. Under the hill, Jojen Reed grew even more sullen and solitary, to his sister's distress. She would often sit with Bran beside their little fire, talking of everything and nothing, petting Summer where he slept between them, while her brother wandered the caverns by himself. Jojen had even taken to climbing up to the cave's mouth when the day was bright. He would stand there for hours, looking out over the forest, wrapped in furs yet shivering all the same. He wants to go home, Mira told Bran. He will not even try and fight his fate. He says the green dreams do not lie. He's being brave, said Bran. The only time a man can be brave is when he is afraid, his father had told him once, long ago, on the day they found the direwolf pups in the summer snows. He still remembered. He's being stupid, Mira said. I hope that when we found your three-eyed crow, now I wonder why we ever came. For me, Bran thought. His green dreams, he said. His green dreams? Mira's voice was bitter. Hodor, said Hodor. Mira began to cry. Bran hated being crippled then. Don't cry, he said. He wanted to put his arms around her, hold her tight the way his mother used to hold him back at Winterfell when he'd hurt himself. She was right there, only a few feet from him, but so far out of reach it might have been 100 leagues. To touch her, he would need to pull himself along the ground with his hands, dragging his legs behind him. The floor was rough and uneven, and it would be slow going, full of scrapes and bumps. I could put on Hodor's skin, he thought. Hodor could hold her and pat her on the back. The thought made Bran feel strange, but he was still thinking it when Mira bolted from the fire, back out into the darkness of the tunnels. He heard her steps recede until there was nothing but the voices of the singers. The moon was a crescent, thin and sharp as the blade of a knife. The days marched past, one after the other, each shorter than the one before. The nights grew longer. No sunlight ever reached the caves beneath the hill. No moonlight ever touched those stony halls. Even the stars were strangers there. Those things belonged to the world above, where time ran in its iron circles, day to night to day to night to day. "It is time," Lord Brendan said. Something in his voice sent icy fingers running up Bran's back. "Time for what?" "For the next step. For you to go beyond skin changing and learn what it means to be a greenseer." "The trees will teach him," said Leif. She beckoned, and another one of the singers padded forward, the white-haired one that Mira had named Snowy Locks. She had a weirwood bowl in her hands, carved with a dozen faces like the ones the heart trees wore. Inside was a white paste, thick and heavy, with dark red veins running through it. "You must eat this," said Leif. She handed Bran a wooden spoon. The boy looked at the bowl uncertainly. "What is it?" "A paste of weirwood seeds." Something about the look of it made Bran feel ill. The red veins were only weirwood sap, he supposed, but in the torchlight they looked remarkably like blood. He dipped the spoon into the paste, then hesitated. "Will this make me a greenseer?" "Your blood makes you a greenseer," said Lord Brendan. "This will help you awaken your gifts and wed you to the trees." Bran did not want to be married to a tree, but who else would wed a broken boy like him? 1,000 eyes, 100 skins, wisdom deep as the roots of ancient trees, a greenseer. He ate. It had a bitter taste, though not so bitter as acorn paste. The first spoonful was the hardest to get down. He almost retched it right back up. The second tasted better. The third was almost sweet. The rest he spooned up eagerly. Whitey thought that it was bitter. It tasted of honey, of new fallen snow, of pepper and cinnamon in the last kiss his mother ever gave him. The empty bowl slipped from his fingers and clattered on the cavern floor. "I don't feel any different. What happens next?" Leif touched his hand. "The trees will teach you. The trees remember." He raised a hand, and the other singers began to move about the cavern, extinguishing the torches one by one. The darkness thickened and crept toward them. "Close your eyes," said the three-eyed crow. "Slip your skin as you do when you join with summer, but this time, go into the roots instead. Follow them up through the earth, to the trees upon the hill, and tell me what you see." Bran closed his eyes and slipped free of his skin. Into the roots, he thought, into the weirwood. Become the tree. For an instant, he could see the cavern in its black mantle, could hear the river rushing by below. Then all at once, he was back home again. Lord Eddard Stark sat upon a rock beside the deep black pool in the Godswood, the pale roots of the heart tree twisting around him like an old man's gnarled arms. The greatsword Ice lay across Lord Eddard's lap, and he was cleaning the blade with an oilcloth. "Winterfell," Bran whispered. His father looked up. "Who's there?" he asked, turning, and Bran, frightened, pulled away. His father and the black pool in the Godswood faded and were gone, and he was back in the cavern, the pale thick roots of his weirwood throne cradling his limbs as a mother does a child. A torch flared to life before him. "Tell us what you saw." From far away, Leif looked almost a girl, no older than Bran or one of his sisters, but close at hand, she seemed far older. She claimed to have seen 200 years. Bran's throat was very dry. He swallowed. "Winterfell. I was back in Winterfell. I saw my father. He's not dead. He's not. I saw him. He's back at Winterfell. He's still alive." "No," said Leif. "He is gone, boy. Do not seek to call him back from death." "I saw him." Bran could feel the rough wood pressing against one cheek. He was cleaning ice. "You saw what you wished to see. Your heart yearns for your father and your home, so that is what you saw." "A man must know how to look before he can hope to see," said Lord Brendan. "Those were shadows of days past that you saw, Bran. You were looking through the eyes of the heart tree in your Godswood." "Time is different for a tree than for a man. Sun and soil and water, these are the things a weirwood understands, not days and years and centuries. For men, time is a river. We are trapped in its flow, hurtling from the past to present, always in the same direction. The lives of trees are different. They root and grow and die in one place, and that river does not move them. The oak is the acorn is the oak, and the weirwood? 1,000 human years are a moment to a weirwood, and through such gates you and I may gaze into the past." "But," said Bran, "he heard me." He heard a whisper on the wind, a rustling amongst the leaves. You cannot speak to him, try as you might. I know. I have my own ghosts, Bran. A brother that I loved. A brother that I hated. A woman I desired. Through the trees, I see them still, but no word of mine has ever reached them. The past remains the past. We can learn from it, but we cannot change it. Will I see my father again? Once you have mastered your gifts, you may look where you will and see what the trees have seen, be it yesterday or last year or 1,000 ages past. Men live their lives trapped in an eternal present, between the mists of memory and the sea of shadow that is all we know of the days to come. Certain moths live their whole lives in a day, yet to them that little span of time must seem as long as years and decades do to us. An oak may live 300 years, a redwood tree 3,000. A weirwood will live forever if left undisturbed. To them, seasons pass in the flutter of a moth's wing, and past, present, and future are one. Nor will your sight be limited to your godswood. The singers carved eyes into their heart trees to awaken them, and those are the first eyes a new greenseer learns to use. But in time, you will see well beyond the trees themselves. When? Bran wanted to know. In a year, or 3, or 10, that I have not glimpsed. It will come in time, I promise you. But I'm tired now, and the trees are calling me. We will resume on the morrow. Hodor carried Bran back to his chamber, muttering Hodor in a low voice as Leif went before them with a torch. He had hoped that Mira and Jojen would be there, so he could tell them what he had seen, but their snug alcove in the rock was cold and empty. Hodor eased Bran down onto his bed, covered him with furs and made a fire for them. 1,000 eyes. 100 skins. Wisdom deep as the roots of ancient trees. Watching the flames, Bran decided he would stay awake till Mira came back. Jojen would be unhappy, he knew, but Mira would be glad for him. He did not remember closing his eyes. But then somehow he was back at Winterfell again, in the godswood looking down upon his father. Lord Eddard seemed much younger this time. His hair was brown with no hint of gray in it. His head bowed. Let them grow up close as brothers, with only love between them, he prayed, and let my lady wife find it in her heart to forgive. Father. Bran's voice was a whisper in the wind, a rustle in the leaves. Father, it's me. It's Bran. Brandon. Eddard Stark lifted his head and looked long at the weirwood, frowning, but he did not speak. He cannot see me, Bran realized, despairing. He wanted to reach out and touch him, but all that he could do was watch and listen. I am in the tree. I'm inside the heart tree, looking out of its red eyes, but the weirwood cannot talk, so I can't. Eddard Stark resumed his prayer. Bran felt his eyes fill up with tears, but were they his own tears or the weirwood's? If I cry, will the tree begin to weep? The rest of his father's words were drowned out by a sudden clatter of wood on wood. Eddard Stark dissolved, like mist in a morning sun. Now two children danced across the godswood, hooting at one another as they dueled with broken branches. The girl was older and taller of the two. Arya, Bran thought eagerly, as he watched her leap up onto a rock and cut at a boy. But that couldn't be right. If the girl was Arya, the boy was Bran himself, and he had never worn his hair so long. And Arya never beat me playing swords, the way that girl is beating him. She slashed the boy across the thigh, so hard that his leg went out from under him and he fell into the pool and began to splash and shout. You be quiet, stupid, the girl said, tossing her own branch aside. It's just water. Do you want old Nan to hear and run and tell father? She knelt and pulled her brother from the pool, but before she got him out again, the two of them were gone. After that, the glimpses came faster and faster, till Bran was feeling lost and dizzy. He saw no more of his father, nor the girl who looked like Arya, but a woman heavy with child emerged naked and dripping from the black pool, knelt before the tree, and begged the old gods for a son who would avenge her. Then there came a brown-haired girl, slender as a spear, who stood on the tips of her toes to kiss the lips of a young knight as tall as Hodor. A dark-eyed youth, pale and fierce, sliced 3 branches off the weirwood and shaped them into arrows. The tree itself was shrinking, growing smaller with each vision, while the lesser trees dwindled into saplings and vanished, only to be replaced by other trees that would dwindle and vanish in their turn. And now the lords Bran glimpsed were tall and hard, stern men in fur and chainmail. Some wore faces he remembered from the statues in the crypts, but they were gone before he could put a name to them. Then, as he watched, a bearded man forced a captive down onto his knees before the heart tree. A white-haired woman stepped toward them through a drift of dark red leaves, a bronze sickle in her hand. No, said Bran, no don't, but they could not hear him, no more than his father had. The woman grabbed the captive by the hair, hooked the sickle round his throat, and slashed. And through the mist of centuries, the broken boy could only watch as the man's feet drummed against the earth. But as his life flowed out of him in a red tide, Brandon Stark could taste the blood. Alright, now I know that was a lot to take in, but let's try to deconstruct some of Bran Stark's visions inside of the Weirwood net. The first thing Bran sees is his father, Lord Eddard Stark, sitting at the Heart Tree in the Godswood. This is taking place shortly after Robert's Rebellion. When Ned Stark says, "Let them grow up as close as brothers," he's talking about Jon Snow and Robb Stark. Ned also hopes that Catelyn can find it in her heart to forgive him, because as we all know, Ned had to lie to Catelyn and tell her he had sex with another woman, which led to the birth of Jon Snow. But if you pay very close attention to the wording during this vision, there is a subtle clue about Jon not actually being Ned's son. If Jon was Ned's son, he would be stepbrothers to Robb, but Ned hopes they grow up as close as brothers, and that's because Ned knows they aren't actually brothers. This is just one of the many pieces to the R plus L equals J puzzle. After the vision of Ned Stark, Bran starts to see other events, in reverse chronological order. They're moving backwards in time, that's why the tree continues to get smaller and smaller. So, the first vision is right after Robert's Rebellion, then we gradually work backwards all the way to Winterfell's earliest days. Bran sees his father talking about Jon and Robb, then he sees two kids sword fighting in the Godswood with sticks. At first, Bran thinks he's seeing his sister Arya, but he's actually seeing his aunt Lyanna and his uncle Benjen when they were still just kids. Now, what Bran sees next is a little harder to decipher. A pregnant woman emerges from the Godswood pool, and she prays before the tree for a son to avenge her. This may not be confirmed until another Duncan Egg novella comes out, but this is most likely one of the she-wolves of Winterfell. There are some other theories about who this could be, but I think the one I just stated makes the most sense if you're following the timeline in reverse chronological order. After that vision, we then see a girl who has to stand on her tippy toes to kiss a knight that is as tall as Hodor. This sounds like it's old Nan, when she was much younger of course, and who she is kissing is Dunk, from the Dunk and Egg novellas that I just mentioned. This makes a lot of sense because the knight was as tall as Hodor, and we all know Hodor is related to old Nan, so now we see where he gets his size from, Sir Duncan the Tall. After that, there is a dark-eyed youth, who cuts three branches off the tree and shapes them into arrows. This is definitely Brandon Snow, who was Torrhen Stark's half-brother. Torrhen Stark is known as the King Who Knelt. He was referenced during Season 7 when Jon Snow met Daenerys Targaryen. Torrhen Stark had actually knelt to Aegon the Conqueror, but the night before he knelt, his brother had plans of sneaking into his camp and killing all three of his dragons. That would explain why he cut off three branches of the tree and fashioned them into arrows. Now, we're not actually sure if this would have worked, but given how magical the Weirwood trees are, I would like to think it would have worked. The next vision is pretty self-explanatory. Bran can see tall lords with stern faces and fur and chainmail. He says he recognizes the faces from the crypts of Winterfell. These are most likely some of the old kings of Winter from way back in the day. The final vision Bran has is my favorite one because it's so mysterious and fascinating to me. This is the sacrifice done right under the Heart Tree by the white-haired woman who has a bronze sickle in her hand. This vision took place thousands of years ago, when the Heart Tree in Winterfell wasn't quite as big as it is now. There are many different theories about what this vision could mean. Who is the white-haired woman? Who is the captive being forced down onto his knees and then executed? Is this a blood sacrifice to the Weirwood Tree? Is the white-haired woman the Night's Queen? One thing is clear, everything that has to do with the old gods is fascinating, but unlocking all their secrets will take a very long time, while some may never be revealed at all. The Starks' history stretches back all the way to the Age of Heroes, and as I've always said, I believe they have a direct connection or even a bond with the Others, also known as the White Walkers. Who these people are in this scene might not really matter, but the act of the sacrifice itself may be what's important, because we all have seen just how powerful a blood sacrifice can be. And this might be one of the very first ones that was ever done at Winterfell, or at the Heart Tree itself. I can only hope that we will find out what was the cause and effect of this sacrifice Bran sees during his final vision. Let me know your thoughts on all of this. If you have anything to add, I would certainly love to hear it. Put your comments down below in the comments section. I want to thank all of you for watching the video, especially if you listened until the very end. I appreciate that as always. Also, I want to give a big thanks to everyone on Patreon for continuing to support the channel. Thank you all very much. Have a great day. I will see you soon. Bye.